Bi erasure can be a major problem. It makes bisexual people feel, well, invisible. So let's talk a little bit about bi erasure in TV. But before we talk about bi erasure on TV, let's discuss what bisexuality and bi erasure actually are. I personally identify as bisexual mostly, and to me that means I'm attracted to people of every gender. To some it can mean being attracted to just a few genders or even just two. But the basic definition of bisexuality is attracted to two or more genders. Now, according to the Encyclopedia of Women in Today's World, bi erasure is defined as, quote, the tendency to ignore, remove, falsify or re-explain evidence of bisexuality in history, academia, news, media, and any other primary sources. In its most extreme form, bisexual erasure can include denying that bisexuality exists. It is often a manifestation of biphobia, although it does not necessarily involve overt antagonism. Basically, this means that bi erasure is the removal of bisexuality or the idea that bisexuality even exists from anywhere. Art, media, news, academic study, or even just acknowledging it within your own community, which can happen within the LGBT community, by the way. So why does bisexual erasure happen? Well, Kenji Yoshino, in her famous essay on bi erasure, says that there are three major reasons for this. The first is, quote, an interest in stabilizing sexual orientation. People like to deal in binaries. Our society is built on the premise of you're either rich or poor, happy or unhappy, a boy or a girl, gay or straight. It's easy to define yourself within these terms. You have one choice or the other. It helps simplify the world around you and bring order to the chaos. But it can also be incredibly limiting. It puts you in a rigid box and doesn't allow for diversity of thought or opinion. It also leads to the erasing of some identities. So the idea of bisexuals seems to challenge one's sexual identity. If you identify as gay or straight, seeing someone as bisexual seemingly calls into question your own sexuality. Am I actually completely gay? Am I actually completely straight? It says that you may not be completely one thing or the other. And this is quite possibly true. Anyone who's heard of the Kinsey scale knows this. And the Kinsey scale is a scale to show you how attracted you are to one sex or the other. And you can be completely on one side where you're completely gay, or on the other side where you're completely straight, or in the middle where you're equally attracted to both. Or you can be like a 2 on the Kinsey scale, where you're mostly attracted to one gender, but not completely not attracted to the other. I know, double negative, it's confusing. But most people fall somewhere on this spectrum. There's nothing wrong with falling somewhere in between. Someone who identifies as a bisexual, though, is just a more evident example of this. And that challenges this binary idea of gay or straight, and therefore challenges the binary worldview. A second reason for bi erasure is very similar to the first, and it is, quote, an interest in retaining sex as a dominant metric of differentiation. This basically means the same thing as the first reason, but applying it to gender rather than sexual orientation. Again, the world likes to see gender and sex as the same thing. If you're born a male, then you're a boy. If you're a female, then you're a girl. But many of us are aware that while sex is biological, and isn't necessarily binary, by the way, is evidenced by intersex people, gender itself can actually come in a multitude of forms. The very existence of bisexuality again challenges that binary idea of sex and genders. While bisexuality can be defined as just having sexual desire between two sexes, it can also be an attraction to multiple genders. Seeing bisexuals defined as desiring across a spectrum can be threatening to that ever-present binary worldview. And we can't have any challenges to the binary. How would we code computers? The third reason presented in Yoshino's essay is, quote, an interest in defending norms against monogamy. In mainstream America, a pair bonding is preferred. We all hear stories of the one, finding that one special person who's bound to be our soulmate. Our society values the bonding of two people and no more than two people. Yet another version of the binary view of the world. A worldview of a boy and a girl, and more recently accommodating a guy and a guy and a girl and a girl. Bisexuals who live in a quote, gray area, are often seen as intrinsically non-monogamous and promiscuous, wanting to be with multiple partners at the same time. I mean, if we're attracted to multiple genders, that must mean we want to be with multiple partners, right? I have personally experienced that misconception within my own family. My family has asked me about my bisexuality and wonders that, well, if I end up with a guy, does that mean I'm feeling like I'm missing out and will want to be with a woman and look for a woman and be like, oh, I wish I had that, and then end up cheating on my male partner? This is clearly not true. Romantic feelings are different than sexual feelings. Someone can be someone who wants to be with just one person and be bisexual at the same time. It doesn't mean that they're going to cheat on them. It just means that they have a larger pool of people that they can maybe, hopefully, find that one with. Also, there's no judgment on polyamory. Polyamory is distinctly different from bisexuality. A bisexual may be attracted to more than one sex or gender, but they may also have a desire to be with one person romantically at a time, just as I said. Just because they're attracted to more than one sex does not mean that they're finding romance in more than one person. That said, this doesn't mean that they can't. A bisexual person may be a polyamorous person as well, but it also is just as true that a polyamorous person is not necessarily bisexual, wishing to be with multiple partners of only one gender. I've personally met polyamorous bisexuals and polyamorous straight people, although I've yet to meet a polyamorous homosexual person, though that doesn't mean that they don't exist. Which is another way people erase identities, by the way. If you haven't seen them, then they must not exist. It's like they're still retaining the idea of object permanence from being a baby. In the end, the impression that we get for the reason of bierasure is that bisexuality calls into question a black and white view of the world. And this can be problematic for how much of our society is set up on every level. Again, boy or girl, guilty or not guilty, gay or straight, rich or poor. It's much easier to say bisexuals don't really exist than to actually accept them and challenge our own worldview. I've had people try to erase my identity to my face, and even from other members of the LGBT community. Oh, you'll eventually pick one, right? Once you settle down with a certain gender, then you'll be gay or straight then. Obviously, that is crap. I'm always bisexual, even if I'm only dating one specific gender. And no, I'm not confused about that. So before we move on to how bierasure appears on television, I just wanted to take a moment and thank you for watching this video. I can't tell you how much I actually really appreciate it. And if you like this video, I would also be extremely appreciative if you would consider giving my channel a subscribe. I literally get excited about every new subscriber. So if you like queer nerdy content, please hit the big red button underneath this video. Now, let's get on to the actual nerdy part of this video. We find a lot of examples of bierasure in television. Certainly, you can have bierasure by a lack of bisexual representation in television, and this, along with other gay and lesbian representations in the past, has definitely been the case. There are certainly a lot less bisexual characters than there are straight characters. However, things get a bit murkier when we dive in deeper, and we see the denying of the very existence of bisexuals, even when it makes sense within what has been written for a television show. A most obvious example of bierasure in the world of science fiction is on the show Buffy the Vampire Slayer, one of my personal favorite shows, in the character of Willow. Willow, played by the wonderful Allison Hannigan, who some may know from How I Met Your Mother, is one of my favorite characters on the show. And she was a character who started off seemingly being written as straight. She dated a guy named Oz, played by Seth Green, and their relationship was an important storyline in the show, and included a storyline about the loss of her virginity to her male companion. It was a very important moment for her character. It was actually an arc for a few episodes about Willow deciding whether she wanted to have sex or not, and was very tastefully done in my opinion. So when she eventually broke up with Oz's character in the third season of the show, it obviously was another important moment for the character. She acknowledged that she loved him, but that they had to move on and go their separate ways. They both had to do something different. Oz had to learn what it means to be a werewolf and things like that, you know, normal college stuff. Never was there any hint that she didn't find him attractive or didn't enjoy their healthy sexual relationship. Not that there would have been anything wrong with that, but it just didn't come up on the show. However, not long after their breakup within the show, Willow became attracted to and eventually started dating a female character, Tara. The romance with Tara would become one of the biggest driving factors for Willow's character throughout the rest of the series. It was one of the first and best real representations of female same-sex relationships on sci-fi television and in primetime television. Yes, there were a few episodes dealing with the fact that they were in a same-sex relationship, but ultimately it wasn't a big deal. And it wasn't even a big deal for most of the characters in the show after a certain point. The show even talked about them having sex and directly implied a female orgasm on screen during the show's musical episode, something that was mostly unheard of for network television up until that point. The characters had a fairly healthy relationship for the most part, outside of one storyline that has been criticized, where Willow used her magic abilities to erase some of Tara's memories to keep her relationship stable. This obviously has some really unfortunate real-world undertones, but that discussion lies outside the realm of this video. Yet, despite the mostly wonderful representation of same-sex love, Willow's depiction can be viewed as problematic, mostly because the show and Willow herself describes herself as a lesbian for the rest of the series, and she starts dating Tara, mostly ignoring her previous relationship with Oz, outside of one episode where Oz returns to learn about Willow's current relationship with a woman. By the way, in that episode, he gets jealous and upset because hashtag toxic masculinity. Now, it's certainly not uncommon for real-life lesbians or gay people to identify as straight in high school, as Willow did, or discover they're lesbians or gay once they're older, once they've had time to explore and learn more about themselves. So while this could be seen as a non-problematic character, Willow's depiction seems to fall more in line with a bisexual character. She never had any issue with her relationship with Oz, flaws, nor seems to have any issues with opposite gender sexual relationships. Yet she describes herself as a lesbian for the rest of the series, and never again dates a man. It would have been much more in line with the actions and seeming desires of Willow for her to be bisexual. Or if they had written her arc as, oh, maybe I don't really like being with a guy or don't like being with men. But that never really came up. So why wasn't Willow given the label of bisexual? There could be numerous reasons, from a specific desire to bi erase or studio censorship. Yet, this is just speculation, but I think the most likely culprit here was twofold. One was the lack of awareness of bisexual identities by the writers of the show. They simply didn't know or didn't really think about bisexuality as a thing, and so decided to label her as a lesbian. Additionally, I think the show's writers really wanted to showcase a lesbian relationship, as LGBT issues were just starting to get tackled in a major way on television at that time, with shows like Will and Grace and the original Queer Eye for the Straight Guy. So, thinking in a binary, they decided to give Willow the label of lesbian, in order to push an LGBT-focused story, instead of having to deal with the incredibly wrong-minded and frustrating idea of bisexuality as not LGBT enough. A similar situation with the show Xena Warrior Princess came up, in which Xena was having an implied relationship with a woman, and yet the bisexual label was never given. However, even more recent examples of bi-erasure have caused issues. In 2009's The Real World, there were two bisexual participants, Emily and Mike. And while Mike identified himself as bisexual, many viewers would write in and talk about him as if he was only gay. It was even revealed that the show was edited to make it look like Mike had only had relationships with men on the show, when in fact he had had both relationships with men and women during his tenure. Even more recently than that, Orange is the New Black certainly has a stronger and better representation of LGBT communities, but even their bisexuals are sometimes ignored. The character of Piper, who is the lead character of the show for the first few seasons, starts the show engaged to a male character and having had a previous self-described lesbian relationship when she was younger. As the show progresses, she cheats on her male fiancé with a fellow female inmate that she had been with before. Yet many characters, including her fiancé, asked, "Are you a lesbian now? Have you become a lesbian again?" Even the character of Piper herself struggles with the idea that she, quote, may be becoming a lesbian again, instead of making room for the possibility that she may be bisexual. Instead of labeling herself as bisexual, or at least exploring that possibility, the character, and therefore the show itself, seem to be more interested with the struggle of flirting between the two binaries instead of comfortably existing somewhere in the middle, which would have made more sense for her character given the actions of her sexual desires, because she obviously still had feelings for both the guy and the girl. And again, I want to be clear here. It's perfectly normal for a gay or lesbian person to have an opposite gender relationship and still identify as gay or lesbian. And that may be actually what these characters are going through. Yet it's a pattern shown over and over and over again, that the writers of a show would rather have a character identify as gay or lesbian, a binary, over having them identify as bisexual. Probably a better example of bisexual representation is found within the DC Comics Arrowverse TV shows, which include the TV shows Arrow, The Flash, Supergirl, Black Lightning, Legends of Tomorrow, Vixen, The Ray, Constantine, and an upcoming Batwoman show. Damn, they have a lot. Specifically, the character of Sarah Lance, who appears on both Arrow and Legends of Tomorrow as a main character. There are a few other bisexual characters, but I want to focus on Sarah. At first, Sarah Lance's sexuality seems to be another example of bi-erasure. While she had a sexual relationship with both men and women, the show never explicitly used the term bisexual for a long time with her character. The show's executive producer stated, quote, "We really wanted to approach it like it was not salacious and be sensitive and be realistic. We specifically avoided using the term bisexual. We didn't want to label her at all. Let her be her own person." I'm certainly all down for the idea of I don't need to label myself, but it's a common line by writers to sweep aside the fact that they don't really want to say the word bisexual. And initially, it seems as if Sarah Lance was going to follow the same line as Willow, in that she only dated several women characters on the show after her not-labeled identity was revealed. If a bisexual person only dates several women in a row, are they denying their bisexuality? Obviously not. You aren't more or less bisexual if you only date one gender. Now, this topic is much larger than this episode, but suffice it to say, it's refreshing to see a character on TV who eschews labels. However, it may be a step too far in the right direction. It seems to bypass the need to actually say bisexuality exists and is a thing. We need to be able to define the label before we can subvert it or move past it. While bisexuals have definitely defined themselves, mass television and media in general still have a long way to go when showcasing and understanding the label of bisexual. Now, to be fair, the Sarah Lance character has gone on to overtly identify as bisexual.
"Because I like men. And I like women."
Including saying as much to a Nazi officer in an episode, as well as sleeping with Constantine, a bisexual man, as well as having a long-term relationship with a woman. There are also many other bisexuals who label themselves bisexual on screen. Take a look at the character of 13 on House. Her relationships on the show were not fetishized, at least not by the writers of the shows themselves. The main character, House, did fetishize her and made several fetishizing jokes about it, but it was supposed to be clear that we were not supposed to side with him on those occasions. And most importantly, at least to this discussion, the character of 13 used the label bisexual.
But just because I'm bisexual?
Well, yeah.
Another great example of bisexual representation on TV is the show Lost Girl. The main character is bisexual, along with several other characters on the show. She has relationships with both a man and a woman, and never seems to be estranged by anyone within the show. What's more is that her non-binary identity is a main theme of the show. Lost Girl is all about a girl finding her way between two extremes. She is asked to join a group of light fae and a group of dark fae, yet her character decides to join neither, instead remaining specifically between the two groups. She actively rejects the world's binary, choosing to live somewhere in between. This is reflected in many things in the show, but it's also reflected by her very sexuality. It's a brilliant decision to use someone's sexuality to highlight stories and themes. It's subtle and more powerful as a result. And in the end, it's important to address bi-erasure, especially within our art. It's helpful for those of us who are bisexual to be able to look up on screen and see parts of ourselves reflected there, to feel like who we are contributes to the soul of society, which is what art is, a depiction of our soul. And so to not see yourself there can sometimes feel hurtful. Yet the erasure of bisexuality doesn't just hurt bisexuals. We live in a world of black and white. We take comfort that things are easily one thing or the other. We constantly look at the decisions in our life and wonder, did I make the right choice or did I make the wrong choice here? Yet the world isn't that simple, and not all of our choices are usually described as right or wrong. We need to acknowledge this, that our world can always be fit into these tiny boxes. And acknowledging bisexuality is one of the ways we can take ourselves out of those boxes. Hey interwebs, thank you so much for watching this video. If you liked this and want even more analysis of geek topics on everything from Star Trek to DC Comics, or you want social and political analysis and discussions, or social and political discussions through geek topics, give my channel a subscribe. And if you want to actively help make my videos even better, consider giving to my Patreon page. Each and every bit helps make these videos truly awesome, and there are some cool perks and benefits of being a Patreon, like having your name listed below, just like these wonderful, amazing people. And finally, I want to give a shout out to Patreon Stefan Schuchart, who is kind enough to be a Patreon at the Admiral level. Thank you so much, Stefan. Your support and the support of my other Patreons truly means the world to me, and it's what keeps me motivated as a creator. But regardless of if you subscribe or give to my Patreon, I hope that all of you live long and prosper.